a nombre de la Facultad de Ciencias Sociales. Esta es una gran oportunidad, ¿cierto?, para todos nosotros para el Departamento de Antropología y para veo egresados también y gente de otras universidades. Recién tuvimos una excelente conferencia que para otra vez esperamos poder tener mejores coordinaciones, ¿no? En este caso con la Sociedad de Antropología Biológica. Pero bueno, doy entonces la bienvenida al doctor Mike Parker Pearson. Yo ya he tenido la oportunidad de escucharlo y lo que nos viene a mostrar hoy día es sin duda muy, muy interesante. Dejo la palabra a Mauricio entonces, Uribe.
Sí, hola, bueno, también unas palabritas muy breves, simplemente agradecerle a ustedes por su presencia y también a Mike por haber venido a Chile, digamos, y poder acompañarnos en nuestro trabajo, digamos, de nuestro proyecto, digamos, que estamos finalizando en estos momentos y por lo tanto ha sido una muy buena excusa para poder concentrarnos en finalizar esta investigación en la Pampa del Tamarugal y relacionada directamente con lo que llamamos nosotros periodo formativo. En esta misma línea que justamente se nos, y como fue también un trabajo muy sugerente de él respecto a Stonehenge, que nos motivó, digamos, a invitarlo, ya que justamente intentamos recoger otras formas y nuevas visiones quizás de ver este tipo de periodos como el neolítico en Europa o en el viejo mundo, el formativo en América y en particular en el norte de Chile, ampliando las perspectivas, particularmente más allá justamente de aquellos elementos como Stonehenge u otros, digamos, en nuestro caso algunas aldeas que han sido muy paradigmáticas para construir relatos sobre el pasado, sobre la prehistoria y que se han constituido en emblemas, de los discursos arqueológicos y también de los discursos nacionales, digamos. Y por lo tanto, justamente el interés nuestro es analizar ese tipo de argumentos, de esos tipos de relatos, de esa forma de construcción y como en el caso que quizás nos va a presentar Mike sobre el Stonehenge Project, tiene que ver con justamente mirar más allá de los monumentos, de la monumentalidad, o de lo que quedó, como las grandes piedras, sino todo lo que hay mucho más allá de eso, y también los distintos tipos de materialidades, que se combinan y donde están las visibles y tan monumentales como esta, como aquellas que son mucho más perecederas y que que no dejan el rastro que dejan las otras, pero que son igualmente importantes, o quizás más importantes al momento de constituir este tipo de monumentalidades del espacio público, comunitario, que justamente son el tema o la situación, la estructura que se están transformando en esto, que no es solamente un cambio económico, neolítico, formativo, no es solamente un cambio económico, sino que es evidentemente un cambio mucho más sustancial, en el desarrollo de la sociedad humana. Así que bueno, esperamos que poder también compartir este tipo de ocasión de tener a investigadores de tan alta calidad, digamos, también es un honor tenerlos acá en la Universidad de Chile, en nuestra facultad, en nuestro departamento. Y bueno, esto tiene estas dos partes, digamos. Esta es Stonehenge más arqueológico y la siguiente charla, la próxima semana, es Stonehenge más patrimonial, ¿ya? Y donde se mezclan ya otro tipo de lecturas, justamente, no solamente la arqueológica. Así que espero que disfruten, digamos, la conferencia de Mike y que, bueno, también puedan hacer las preguntas que les parezcan pertinentes. Mike.
Thank you very much, Mauricio. It's a great pleasure and honor to be invited to come to Santiago. I'm sorry, but my Spanish is terrible. So I will have to speak in English. And I've tried to provide some Spanish words in the PowerPoint to help if the English is a bit difficult. Now, I've been working on Stonehenge for 13 years. Since 2003, and I have to say I was never going to study it at all. Because Stonehenge has always attracted some very strange people with very strange ideas. And I will talk about some of those next week on the lecture on the 18th of January. But what drew me to Stonehenge and what led to a big project with many British archaeologists working with a consortium of different universities, so a very major collaboration with hundreds of students, and it became a big project that is still running today. And as you can see, we have three separate projects that have evolved during the course of our investigations. First, what we called the Stonehenge Riverside Project, then Feeding Stonehenge, to investigate the resourcing. How many people were required? How many cattle and sheep and pigs were needed to feed everybody working on the project? Where were they living? How were they living? And then the final project that we're still in, up to 2016, which we will continue this coming year, the Stones of Stonehenge. Because Stonehenge has stones, some of them come from hundreds of kilometers away from Stonehenge. For prehistory, it is one of the longest transportations of megaliths, somewhere around 280 kilometers. Why? So we will look at that a bit later. That is the current investigation. Now, the reason that I got involved was because of my research in Madagascar, so an island a very long way away from England, and it was there that I was working in the 1990s with Malagasy archaeologists, one of whom is the researcher Ramili Sonina. And in 1998, we had the opportunity for Ramili Sonina to come to England to see Stonehenge. And he said, "You do know what it was for? What was its purpose?" And I said, "No, we have no idea." And he looked at me as if I was stupid. And he said, "We have been working together for 10 years on megaliths in Madagascar. Have you learned nothing? Because in Madagascar, stones are put up for the ancestors. And of course, traditionally, we build our houses in wood because life is temporary. But the world of death of the ancestors is for eternity. It is permanent. So we need stone to mark that permanence of the ancestors." And this very simple idea, I thought, I wonder. And then we started to look at the landscape of Stonehenge and to understand that there was a place in stone, but there were also timber circles that we thought might be associated with the living. Just a little further up the river, this is known as the River Avon. So we suggested a hypothesis that Stonehenge was a place of the ancestors, and that the timber circles of Durrington Walls and Woodhenge was a place of the living, and that the river was the connecting line between the two. We knew there was an avenue linking Stonehenge to the river, but was there an avenue linking Durrington Walls and Woodhenge to the river? Was this area indeed a place of the living? Was Stonehenge indeed a place of the dead? So that was the hypothesis we set out to investigate for the first stage of the project. And since then, we have carried out over 40 excavations within the Stonehenge World Heritage Site. Some of those are marked in blue, and you can see some in the area around Stonehenge, and many in the area around Durrington Walls and Woodhenge. The chronology for the period, we are looking at the end of the Stone Age and the beginning of the Bronze Age. We are now recognizing in Britain that from the end of the Neolithic to the beginning of the Bronze Age, there is a very short Copper Age, a Chalcolithic of just 300 years. Within this period, in red, Stonehenge went through five constructions. The first of these, very shortly after 3000 BC. The second one, around 2500. The third one, around 2300. And then two more in this later period, around 2200 and around 1600. Now, only the first two stages will I talk about tonight, because they are the most interesting and the most relevant. But to put Stonehenge into its slightly wider regional perspective, it is one of a number of henge complexes in southern Britain. And you can see there is a line of them following the high ground. And this is calcareous rock, what we call chalk. And Stonehenge is here, as you can see, Durrington Walls, we've already seen this region in detail. But there are other large enclosures, which we call henges. They don't always have standing stones in them. In many cases, they were associated with timber monuments. For 300 years, people have thought that maybe Stonehenge was a temple of the Druids. Now, the Druids are a historical group that were described by classical authors like Julius Caesar. And the reason that this association has come to be is because 300 years ago, when the hypothesis was put forward, it was thought that British prehistory was a very short period of time. Now, the archaeologists who were investigating this 300 years ago were clever enough to know that Stonehenge was a prehistoric monument. But they thought that it was only from just before the time of Julius Caesar and the invasion of Britain by the Romans. So what these researchers, particularly this man, William Stukeley, thought was that if he looked at Julius Caesar's account, if Stonehenge was a temple, that was his interpretation, then who would have been the priests that would have used that temple? So in Julius Caesar's accounts, he talks about these Druids as the religious officials within prehistoric Britain. But it has now stuck, and if you go to Stonehenge, you might even see a real Druid, because today it has become a religion. So in our last population census, there were some 4,000 people who wrote down their religion as Druid. And every year at midsummer, they go to Stonehenge for a big festival. Now, it's almost certain that Druids had nothing to do with Stonehenge. But that doesn't put people off. And I think throughout the world now, everybody thinks Stonehenge, yes, Druids. Unfortunately, very unlikely. One of the important features of Stonehenge is its astronomical alignments. And as I'm sure you all know, the main axis of it out to the avenue is on the line of the solstice, sunrise and sunset. So, midsummer sunrise in this direction, midwinter sunset in this direction. And this was something that was discovered in the previous century, and in the 1960s, archaeologists and astronomers began to think of all the possible reasons that there might be such unusual extraterrestrial astronomical associations. And indeed, there are many people today who send me emails to tell me about how Stonehenge can only have been built by people from outer space. So, I'm afraid we have not found any evidence of any spacecraft or aliens at Stonehenge. It is indeed an entirely indigenous monument, as I guess you probably have worked out. So back to the archaeology. What do we know? And there are two main phases. The first construction stage of Stonehenge, just shortly after 3000 BC, we have a ditch, a bank, and then a circle of pits, of holes, and then other pits within the interior. Now, most of the interior has never been excavated, so we only have the vaguest idea of what is in the center of the monument. But in the main entrance here, we have other holes. Many of these are for wooden posts, but some of them are for stones. And we now think that this circle also held stones. Most interestingly, while these were for local stones, these are too small for those, and we think that these must have been the stones that we call blue stones that came from 280 kilometers away on the west coast of Britain, in the land of West Wales. The second stage is when Stonehenge took the form that it has today, because they moved the Welsh stones into a central setting here, and then inside of it they constructed a horseshoe of trilithons, each trilithon two uprights and a stone on top, and then around the outside a circle of uprights with lintel stones running around the top. These bigger stones are what we call sarsen. So they are a local sandstone within the area of Stonehenge. They probably come from 30 kilometers to the north. So they are more local, but even so, they're much bigger. Whereas the Welsh bluestones weigh only 2 to 3 tons, these weigh between 10 and 30 tons. When we started our project, we were interested in this relationship between Stonehenge as a place of the ancestors and Durrington Walls and Woodhenge as a place of the living. There had been excavations here throughout the 20th century, but they had never found any real evidence for the living. They had found some of the big timber circles, two of them within Durrington Walls, and of course Woodhenge. So three timber circles. There is Woodhenge, there is the northern circle, the southern circle, discovered when a new road was put through in the 1960s. We carried out new excavations here and here and here, and we discovered that underneath the ditch and the bank of this big henge, there was a settlement dating to the same period as the second stage at Stonehenge. And then that settlement was abandoned and the ditch and bank were constructed in this period, in the middle of the 25th century BC. Destroying the remains of the village. This is a reconstruction of one of those timber circles, the southern circle within Stonehenge. Its first stage, contemporary with the main settlement, but also with the second stage of Stonehenge, when the large sarsens were brought in to accompany the blue stones. Those excavations at Darrington Walls revealed that there was an avenue linking the southern circle to the River Avon, just like there was an avenue from Stonehenge to the River Avon, and that this too had a solstitial axis different from the ones at Stonehenge towards midsummer sunset. But most importantly, as well as the avenue, which is running this way down to the river, we discovered that there were the remains of houses surrounding Darrington Walls, lived in before the bank and the ditch were constructed. So here are some of those houses, but they came in a variety of forms. Ordinary houses, small annexes, and what we called gazebos. So that is the translation I have been given, pabéon. So open-sided, but all of them with a fireplace in the middle. You can see them more clearly here, and they are surrounded by this black soil. And this is Neolithic trash. This is a deep deposit of refuse, which is full of animal bones and pottery and burnt stones and stone tools. A very, very dense concentration. From our Bayesian analysis of radiocarbon dates, this entire settlement was occupied for less than 45 years. And we think from the replasterings on the floors, it was probably not in use for more than 10 years. So if this is the settlement where the builders of stage two of Stonehenge lived, then they would have been here to build Stonehenge in just a decade, in just 10 years or so. Now, the trash here has given us some very interesting information about the people. We can reconstruct from our various excavations in different parts of the settlement, we can reconstruct the overall appearance. So a large plaza within the middle. The main timber circle, the southern circle, the avenue aligned on the solstice, the entrance here for this timber circle facing towards midwinter sunrise. And then most of the settlement gathered around the outside and in the central area, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 separate houses, each set within their own enclosure. So we think that this one is the principal house. It is no bigger than any of the others, but it has architectural features, a very high roof, for example, which suggests that it may have been the house of somebody special. So if there was a chief or some individual organizing the building of Stonehenge, I think this would have been their house. It's located right in the middle with views across the entire settlement and right down to the river. This is the largest Neolithic settlement that we have ever found in Britain. And our British Neolithic really does not have villages. It is a dispersed settlement pattern, mostly of single houses. So to find this is really quite extraordinary. And we estimate that there would have been about 4,000 to 5,000 people living at Darrington Walls, even if it was only for a short time. We could say a lot more also about the seasonality of when people were gathering there in large numbers. So my colleagues who have been studying the faunal remains and the isotopes of those animals have discovered that, as I'll say more about this in detail, from the strontium isotope analyses, they are bringing the pigs and the cattle from distant parts of Britain. So it had a very large hinterland or catchment, over 800 kilometers or so. We also know that they are feasting, particularly at this time of the year, in the autumn and winter. Now that said, animals were being killed throughout the year, so there may have been a small population perennially, but at the winter time in particular was when large numbers of people came for feasting. We also know that in particular they are cooking mostly pig with small amounts of beef, and as well as barbecuing, they are boiling in large pots. So part of a big feasting arrangement of barbecuing on spits and also boiling the meat as well. Now let us take a look at the cattle, where we have published some of our results on the distances, likely distances from the strontium isotope analysis. So for each of these is a jawbone of a single animal. So we have about 85 cattle that we have sampled to work out where they grew up, as opposed to where they have all ended up here at Stonehenge. Now all of those that fall in this range come from the blue. This is chalk, the calcareous geology. So given that Stonehenge is there, it is most likely that these animals were local to the region. So they may not have been brought very far. Similarly, this group and this group have come from these green areas. So again, many of them could have come from no more than 30 or 40 kilometers away. But then, looking at these two, the closest geology that they could have grown up on is either here or here. And then this number, with these very high levels, these values are found in Britain only in Scotland. So some 800 kilometers to the north. So we think that this was a project not just for the people of southern Britain, but for the population of the entire island. Now, the problem, of course, is that these are the animals that must have been brought by humans, and we can use them as a proxy to identify the human movements to Stonehenge. But what about the humans themselves? And of course, the problem is that Durrington Walls, because it was for the living, there are no human burials. All we have are occasional, well, four pieces of human bone and one human tooth. Here it is. It is a, what is it? I think it's a premolar. And the value of this means that this was somebody who did not live locally to Stonehenge, but maybe came from this area of Wales, or from this area, or maybe even further away. And of course, what is interesting is that this area, and just here, is where many of the stones for Stonehenge came, the blue stones. What about Stonehenge? Well, we knew from old excavations that there were human remains, mostly cremated bones from cremation burials. They had been excavated, in the most part, in the 1920s, so nearly 100 years ago. And in those days, archaeologists thought they had no value. So what did they do? In 1935, they dug a hole and they put them all in there. And only in 2008 did we re-excavate this hole to find out who they were. I thought they might be good archaeologists, aware of context, aware of the significance of keeping the bones from each burial separate in their own container, maybe marked up so that there would be information about where each burial came from? No. They were all mixed together. So very disappointing. You can see the top of the deposit there. 500,000 cremated human bones. And I have a PhD researcher who is very patient because she has been through the entire assembly. She has looked at every single bone. So what do we have? We know from the 1920s and later excavations that archaeologists have recovered 63 cremations. That if we were to go and dig the rest of Stonehenge, we would probably find a total of over 200. It's a big cemetery. It is, in fact, the biggest cemetery of the entire millennium anywhere in Britain. A cemetery that was in use for more than half a millennium between its start at 3000 BC until after the second stage of Stonehenge. It's an interesting composition because there are virtually no children. The majority are adults and a split between women and men. In fact, there are slightly more women represented than men. We also have new results from the isotopes, analyzing them. We have not, this has not yet been published, but it will be published in 2017. And what this shows is that a quarter of the people buried at Stonehenge, so 25%, did not grow up in that region on the calcareous chalk. And that most of them are likely to have come from the kinds of geology that we find in West Wales. So we think that there must have been an important relationship between the place that provided the bluestones, 280 kilometers away to the west, and Stonehenge. That not just stones moved, but people as well. Our investigation of this landscape revealed a new henge, never before discovered, at the end of this avenue. And we called it Bluestone Henge because there were holes for stones removed, but we could tell from the shapes of those holes that they had held not sarsen stones, but the thin pillars that we call bluestones. Here is that avenue coming down to the river, stopping somewhere around here. And then we found the remnants of a circle, part of it washed away by the river. And this is a henge ditch, but inside of it, we found a circle of interconnecting pits. So in red and posh, estimated ones in yellow, but we think this probably was entirely circular for about 25 standing stones. And we could also see from the impressions in the bottoms of the pits that they are rectangular shapes or unusual shapes that are not like those of timber posts, but of stones. These were pulled out somewhere around 2300 BC. The dating evidence that we have suggests that they were put up around 3000 BC when the first stage of Stonehenge was built. And that if these blue stones were put up here, then we would expect to have some 56 blue stones there, some 25 blue stones there, so around 80 of the Welsh stones installed at Stonehenge in two separate monuments. We also discovered, investigating along the avenue, and of course this is the famous axis looking towards midwinter solstice sunrise, sorry, sunset, midwinter solstice sunset on that horizon. When we excavated the avenue, and you can see there's a ditch here running along like so, another ditch here, running along like so. We also had these banks here and here. And then we discovered also that there were gullies in between them on the solstitial axis. And the surprise for us and our geoarchaeologists, our geomorphologists, was that these are natural. These are glacial or periglacial features formed around 25,000 years ago in tundra conditions. So the ice was at least 80 kilometers to the north. So this would have been an ice desert when these features were formed. And coincidentally, they are aligned on the solstice. What we think we are looking at by carving this monument with its ditches like this is that they discovered this natural phenomenon of lines in the land aligned on astronomical solar movements. So that they must have assumed that this was a place that was very special, perhaps an axis mundi, a center, an axis of the world. Now, not far away from where Stonehenge was later put up, 5,000 years earlier, a line of large timber posts was erected in the period at the beginning of the Holocene that we call the early Mesolithic, long before farmers in the time of hunter-gatherers. This monumentality is unique for the early Mesolithic in Europe. And it just happens to be very close to this particular natural phenomenon. So we think that it might have been something that was chanced upon, discovered by hunter-gatherers long before Stonehenge, giving this particular place in the landscape a significance that could have either continued over thousands of years or been rediscovered by Neolithic people. And recently, other archaeologists have discovered a large settlement of the Mesolithic period down by the river. And the dates in black are the radiocarbon dates that they have from this settlement. So 30,000 flint artifacts, and quantities of animal bone, and we have many different kinds of tool. Interestingly, this is not silex, this is not flint, this is of a stone that is likely to come from the west of Britain, perhaps from Wales. Now I want to finish off by talking about the significance of the stones. So the Sarsens are likely to come from 30 kilometers to the north, where we have another famous henge called Avebury. But as I said before, the bluestones, our geologists have pinpointed them as coming from this region here. So you can see it's a very long distance. Archaeologists have always wondered whether maybe they took a route by sea, bringing stones on rafts or in boats. And remember, these are on average 2 tons. So that's a lot to put in your Neolithic canoe. Another possibility is that they might have come over land, following these valleys, crossing these rivers, and then down like so. We don't know. We don't know. But we now know a lot about the area where they came from, because our geologists have been able to identify specific locations, outcrops where the different types of stone from Wales have their origin. I'm going to talk really about these two, Craig Rosavellin and Carn Goedog, because it is here that we have excavated 2 of the quarries for these bluestones. Now, many of them are of a particular type called spotted dolerite. So a volcanic stone that formed in magma chambers about 480 million years ago. And they form this ridge, and our geologists have found that many of those at Stonehenge, can be matched only at this tiny little outcrop on the north side of the Preseli Hills. There are also different types of rhyolite, one of which comes from down here, Craig Rosavellin, but maybe only one particular stone. This is the outcrop that the geologists have been able to pinpoint with their analysis. And what they discovered was that the rhyolite all the way around is different in its microscopic character. So using geochemistry and petrography, they've been able to see that in fact the quality of the lava, and rhyolite is solidified sheet lava, just happens to be different wherever you look on this outcrop. And for the type at Stonehenge, we can identify it basically as coming from right here. That's the precise location. There is the sample taken, and this is a recess where a pillar has been removed. So we have the exact location where one of the stones for Stonehenge was taken. So that's this position here. And next to it, this dark soil, and just in here we have a fireplace and occupation debris, and we have dated the nutshells from that occupation to show that people were here beside that stone just before Stonehenge. There is also other evidence for quarrying. You can see this big stone here, which is set on large posts. And we were hoping that this might also be the remains of Neolithic quarrying. But our radiocarbon dates from the artificial platform on which this is sitting down here were 1,000 years later. So this actually dates to the early Bronze Age. But it shows that these quarries were revisited again in prehistory. But the most significant quarry is this one, Cwm Goedog. And as you can see, it's quite a remarkable location. And like Craig Rosavallen, the rock has formed these natural pillars. So you don't actually have to hack them out with big stones. All you have to do is to ease each pillar away from the others, because they are already formed as pillars. Now, what we know is that these five came from this quarry. We don't know exactly where, but we have an area of prehistoric stone removal here, possibly here as well, but this area has been disturbed by quarrying just 200 years ago, where they were using drills, steel drills, to actually remove the stone. Fortunately, this area has been untouched since prehistory. Now, we suspect that many more of the bluestones are also likely to have come from Cwm Goedog. The difficulty is getting permission to go into Stonehenge with a big drill to drill holes in these stones. We are currently working on non-destructive sampling using portable XRF. So within the next 3 or 4 years, we may be able to characterize the rest of the bluestones without having to drill holes in them. But back at Cwm Goedog, you can see where here is a pillar ready to be taken away. Just where I'm standing in this recess, there would have been 2 or 3 that have been moved. So we think, just like the other quarry of rhyolite, this is where some of those stones were taken away. Now this is the outcrop, looking at an aerial photo, and then we have an artificial platform of slabs, and then they dug a ditch, for reasons we don't know, filled it with stone, and then we have an exit ramp coming out just there. Here's the ditch, and we're waiting for radiocarbon dates on that. Oh, and I should just say, the radiocarbon dates that we have place the quarrying of these stones just before 3000 BC. So they come from the soil on which this platform is resting. We also have stone tools, but not so much hammer stones, more stones to wedge in the fissures between the pillars. And of course, the problem is that these are probably just the small part of what would have been a much larger assemblage of organic tools, wooden wedges, and antler picks and ropes. Fortunately, some of their tools, though, they made out of stone, and we can see from the damage on them the marks of where they've been inserted into gaps in the rock, that these would have been used to wedge and widen the fissures. Now the question is, why was this area important? Why did they decide to move these stones so very far away? Was there an important center here? And if so, what happened? Was it taken over by the people of southern England? Did they capture this area and say, we want your stones in tribute? Or was it the other way around, that the people here were extending their power and taking over the area that is Stonehenge? And that's a question we don't know. There are many other comparisons of stone moving long distances. We know, for example, within the Inca Empire, that the andesite blocks that were quarried at Cusco, a thousand of these, each weighing half a ton, appear to have been moved to a regional capital in Ecuador, something like 800 kilometers away. We know that Egyptians moved obelisks many hundreds of kilometers up and down the Nile. But for prehistoric societies that were not state societies, this is exceptional. So what we've been looking for in the area between the quarries, is there anything in here that might have been the place where these stones were quarried from to be put up as one or more stone monuments in that area? And we've been searching for 7 years. No, 6 years. And finally, at the end of our last field season, we found this. We're pretty sure it's a henge. And very possibly, we have showing up in the magnetometer results what may be remnants of holes, possibly where stones were once put up and taken away. But we will only find that out through excavation in 9 months' time. I have been so very excited about this that it's been difficult to sleep sometimes. So we will hopefully get an answer as to whether this really was the site of the first Stonehenge in Wales. And if so, what can it tell us about the relationships between East and West? Now we think that those relationships may go back another 1,000 years to the beginning of agriculture within Britain. Agriculture, we know, was imported from mainland Europe around 4000 BC. And we also know that we have two early Neolithic cultures in Britain. One coming from central Europe across the Channel, Calais to Dover, but another one coming from the Mediterranean and from Iberia up to Brittany and then to Ireland and to West Wales. So one possibility is that not only was Stonehenge a monument to the ancestors, but actually it's uniting the ancestors of the two different Neolithics, East and West, 1,000 years after initial settlement. Why Stonehenge? Because it may have had this significance as an axis mundi. And as one of a group of Neolithic monuments that appear to be gathering places that run from here down to here, we think that this may have been a boundary between the territories, so potentially a neutral zone between them. So, of course, this work is something that has been done by a huge team. I am just one of many directors, and as you can see, we have specialists in a huge range of scientific methods, So what I've been able to tell you tonight has really been the hard work of hundreds of students and researchers over more than 10 years. Thank you very much.
Bueno, preguntas en inglés o en español, las traducimos entre todos.
You translate. Oh, right, over there.
Mike. You have been to Easter Island too.
So I've been to.
You have been to Easter Island.
Easter Island, recently,
I think. Yeah. There's a relation between big stones and movements of some amount of kilometers of nearly statues of about 30, 40, even though the highest I think is 80 tons, that they moved about 15 kilometers or something like that. But they covered in the quarries, they moved them to the ahus, to the places, the ceremonial places, and then they finished carving. Is there something like that here? Is it you have remains of carving in Stonehenge?
Yes, indeed we do.
What? Yeah.
And if I had longer to I could have shown you the stone dressing area where they shaped the sarsen stones. So the sarsens, all but one of them has been shaped. So that's over 80 shaped stones in the sandstone, the sarsen. And we excavated the center of the dressing area, the shaping area, which is actually outside of Stonehenge. So we think that they carried out rough dressing, coarse dressing, in the area where the stones were found, their place of origin. This is about 30 kilometers to the north. And then they shaped them. So this would have been for the second stage of Stonehenge around 2500, outside of the monument. Now we also think that when they came into Stonehenge and when they put them up, they did further dressing with them vertical. But the main fine dressing had already been done while they were lying down. And we think this was done in two stages because the dressing of the inner horseshoe is different techniques to the outer sarsen circle. Now the blue stones is very different because there is no evidence that the quarries in Wales that they were shaped at that location, and in fact less than half of the blue stones at Stonehenge were shaped at all. It is only a small proportion. And we have dressing debris for those inside Stonehenge. So we think that those were shaped after they had reached Stone, after they had been up at Stonehenge, sometime after 3000 BC. The ones that are shaped have the same style of dressing as the horseshoe of trilithons. So we think that they would have been shaped at the same time, around 2500, about 500 years after they arrived from Wales. So, but this is, it's a unique thing to do. We don't find this kind of shaping anywhere in the megalithic cultures of Britain. So it is utterly unique to Stonehenge.
Thank you.
¿Más preguntas?
Hi Mike, thank you. I want to ask you what, if you could talk more about the relationship between the megalith culture of Britain and the rest of Europe. What's the relationship between the populations that were building these places?
Yes.
Especially in terms of dates, is what happening in Britain later dates?
Or? Yes. For those that came to the symposium on Monday, I was able to explain that in Western Europe, Our earliest secure dates for the beginning of megaliths are in Brittany around 4500 BC, but it's generally not until 500 years later that other parts of Western Europe take up the megalith tradition. And that runs all the way from Iberia to Scandinavia. But what is interesting, what I have found particularly interesting about Stonehenge is that whereas the earliest megaliths in Britain date to around 3,800 to 3,400, which is a time when Britain was in contact and communication and trade with the rest of Europe, from 3,400 BC, for the next 1,000 years, so the period of Stonehenge, there is no evidence of contact or communication across the channel at all. It's what I call Neolithic Brexit. It's a time when on the continent we see the arrival of the wheel and of copper metallurgy around 3000 BC. But Britain remained backwards in not taking on these innovations. Instead, they built Stonehenge. And then it all changes dramatically around 2400 with the arrival of what we call the Beaker people, who are part of a large-scale movement of populations that have originally started in the steppes of what is now Ukraine. And that is one of the major, it looks to be a major tipping point, a major discontinuity within prehistory. These are groups that were not interested in building megaliths, and at that point the whole large monument and megalith building episode came to an end. So yes, initially it's part of the Western European project, but it becomes insular and specialized. And what makes Stonehenge different from all the other major monuments and monument complexes in the rest of northwestern Europe is the sheer effort, the millions of person hours invested in building this mega monument, rather than people building lots of separate monuments. Yes, there are many smaller separate monuments, but it's something that we don't really find in Europe, certainly not in the third millennium, is this construction of an absolutely massive place by thousands. So for those that are used to American terms of phrase, it's that for a while they're all working for the man. They're laboring for a central authority. And then when we get the Beaker people arriving, they're not prepared to do that anymore. And the monuments are much smaller. The structure is more decentralized.
Thank you.
Anyone?
Hi, Mike. It's a very specific question. You said that the central house in the Darrington Wall had a high roof.
Yes.
How do you know that?
Well, we infer it from the nature of the posts, so that the usual construction of these houses is a simple wall of wattle and daub. Yes, does that translate, wattle and daub? So the weight is held on the wall, but that particular house also has four posts within the center of the house around the fireplace, so indicating that it would have had some kind of, you know, the roof load has been taken on those posts. So we assume that that means that it would have actually been a rather more substantial roof. And it's interesting that its area is no different to other houses, but it may well have looked rather different, perhaps slightly taller, set within its own enclosure, and also placed within this very central position.
Thanks.
Boris?
Hello, Professor.
Hello.
Thank you for the presentation. I have a brief question about the animals. Did you have evidence of hunting animals, wild animals, or just domesticated?
Yes. It's interesting with our British Neolithic, because although we have many wild animals, so oxen and deer in particular, wild pig, they very rarely turn up on our Neolithic sites, whether in ceremonial deposits, whether in pits associated with settlements. What we have at Durrington Walls is that 99% of the animal bones are domestic, but they were shooting the pigs with arrows. So we find some of the pig bones have arrow projectiles still lodged in the bones. We think that this was not done directly, because sometimes they're here and here and here, so it looks like they were shot from a distance. So we think that they may have had sport before they roasted or boiled the meat by shooting at the animals, maybe within the plaza that they let them loose. But yes, the mystery is that they're domesticated animals and yet they're being hunted, but we think that that was some kind of ceremonial event before the barbecue.
How about the research on the social, cultural, any economical and political system around it?
So on the wider society?
Yes.
Yes, yes. I think we have been through many different theoretical frameworks. So for example, my professor when I was an undergraduate student was Colin Renfrew. And in the 1970s, he proposed a model of Neolithic British society as evolving from tribal systems, acephalous, into what he called group-oriented chiefdoms, and then individualizing chiefdoms. And at that time, we thought that Stonehenge was built in the Bronze Age. We now know it's earlier than that. So he saw Stonehenge as the culmination of social evolution, being built not simply by an individualizing chiefdom, but in fact by a confederation of chiefdoms. Those ideas, which were very much associated with measuring complexity, were part of the new archaeology, the processual archaeology, and came to be quite rigorously criticized by the post-processual archaeology. And there was a tendency in the post-processual archaeology to say, we don't need chiefs, we have primitive socialism. and it is true to say that it's very difficult to actually identify any individuals, particularly through the burial record, and by and large through the settlement record, to see evidence of inequality. Now, I think what has been interesting about our excavations is that the fact that there are certain residences within the plaza that are separated from the rest, that we talked about maybe having a slightly higher roof in one of them. The fact that whoever was buried at Stonehenge seems not to have been part of the ordinary population, that there must, there seem to be some rationale. Where are all the children, for example? Because this would have been a time of high infant mortality. So there are odd kind of suggestions that there is some kind of inequality. And we have found with the houses themselves, some were occupied by people who were cooking food, but in other houses that were inhabited, there is very little cooking waste. So we think that some houses were actually providing for other houses within the settlement. And so potentially there were relationships of inequality in terms of the serving of food. But It's all very vague, and I think we're not looking at the kinds of hierarchy that often archaeologists are so used to when we excavate extraordinary and unusual burials. Now, in fact, this is generally true of the European Neolithic, that it is often hard to see these kinds of inequalities, and ones that we particularly recognize in the Chalcolithic and in the Bronze Age. That said, there are times and places, so for example, Brittany around 4500, where we do see marked inequalities in burial practices. Some individuals buried under huge mounds with large numbers of artifacts. But that's very much a passing tradition. It comes and it goes. So I think we have to be aware that these are quite fluid in their politics. And what we're seeing with Stonehenge, I think, is more explicable, not in terms of understanding it as a level of social organization, but simply as a major political confluence of groups all coming together. And of course, within the material culture of that period, although it is isolated from the rest of Europe, we see in that period the sharing of common styles of material culture and monuments right across Britain. So it's the first time, when they build Stonehenge, it's the first time that there is a united material culture within Britain. So I think that may be something partly to do with how we should investigate it. So that's the best I can say at the moment.
Any other question? Esto está reservado hasta las 8, así que no podemos ir. About a wheel found it in Britain. The old one, it's nearly 3,000 years from now,
yes.
BP. And that's 2,000 years far from Stonehenge,
yes,
to the present. So if they don't have wheels, or they have wheels, they are wheels older than this one they found in Must Farm?
Must Farm, Must, yes. Farm. There is a slightly earlier wheel, not far from Must Farm, about 20 kilometers away, which dates to about 1300 BC. But given that Stonehenge was being put up in 3000 BC and then 2500 BC, they're there a long time after. Now, we know that there are wheels in the Netherlands around 3000 BC, the same time as Stonehenge. But, as I said, we have absolutely no evidence cross-cultural communication. There are no styles shared across the channel at that point. There are no traded artifacts on either side. So my feeling is that a lot of the transport of these big stones, when it is over land, is done using different methods. In any case, wheels would not have strong enough axles to support these heavy stones. For a long time, everybody has thought, you know, for more than 150 years, that rollers are the way to move these big stones. And I have a research student who has been doing some study of the history of the interpretation of rollers, and he thinks now that it was a Victorian myth that actually they never used rollers. And what we have learned again from ethno-archaeology, from my own work in Madagascar, but also when we look at places like Sumba in Indonesia, that actually it is just muscles and ropes and wooden sledges. So you slide, you put the stone on a sledge and you pull the sledge. And maybe you put timbers down to support, to make the ground firm, but they do not roll. We also have iconography from ancient Egypt and ancient Mesopotamia from the Bronze Age, and they show great statues being moved in a similar way. There are no rollers, The timbers are laid in the direction of movement just to form a firm footing for the wooden sledge. So we think that actually dragging and sliding is the most likely way to do this. Our problem, I think, has been living in the 20th and 21st century. The people who like to think about these questions are often engineers, and they work with a contemporary ethnocentric mindset of how little effort can we expend to move a big stone. But if we're looking at ethno-archaeological examples, if we're thinking about prehistory, the question is not how little effort, how much effort, how many people can we get to pull this great stone? Can we get 500? Can we get 1,000 people? Because the more people, the greater the event, the greater the significance, the greater the honor of the whole thing. So I think, you know, we've been looking at this down the wrong end of the telescope. But that's kind of different from your original question.
Yeah. What about the landscape between quarries and Stonehenge?
Very difficult.
Difficult?
Down, yeah. Yes. But what is interesting, I think, is that the quarries are on the wrong side of the Preseli Mountains to use the sea route. So my guess is that they're going overland. But we also know that the quarries are very close to another quarry for axes, for Neolithic stone axes, from about 1,000 years before this particular time. And we know from the distribution of those axes that they have come from that location inland along the river valleys. Valleys that we know were settled for thousands of years before. So we think that these would have actually been well-traveled routes, paths through the forest. So then to move big stones along those routes may not have been so difficult. Most of the blue stones are actually no more than 1.5 tons, and we know from ethnographic examples that in difficult parts of the world, in Assam in India, in the Himalayas in Nepal, people in the 20th century have carried weights of 1.5 tons by having 60 men big timbers, and there is footage on YouTube of 60 men carrying a Mercedes-Benz weighing 1.5 tons through the Himalayas. So there are other ways when the stones are not so big that you can actually move them through very difficult terrain. So maybe some of the blue stones were even carried, but I think dragging is most likely.
Last one. You know about the different theories about moving statues in Israel?
Yes.
One of them is moving standing statues.
Dr. Love's theory.
People, not too much effort.
Yeah.
Two of them trying to move them this way, mm-hmm. and the other one supported by the back. And not too much people move 5 tons. Stones as an example. So, is there any option of that?
We've thought about this closely because one of the people leading the Easter Island research, Colin Richards, he's one of the directors on our project. And what we've noticed is that, of course, the Moai have these convex bases, and that makes it much easier. And of course, that doesn't apply to the Stonehenge stones. So, and I think Colin is quite taken by the idea of moving them standing up. I think he likes that idea. I know that there are some archaeologists that hate it, and they don't speak to Dr. Love because they hate the idea of them moving upright. But yes, but I think the Stonehenge ones will have had to go horizontally.
Mauricio, te doy el pase.
Thank you very much.